Welcome to Wintergatan Wednesdays. Today I am starting to build the marble transportation system. It's a closed loop of marbles running around the whole marble machine X, and we're gonna start up here around the marble divider. I have designed the marble tracks from transparent PMMA pipe, which makes the marbles visible at all times when they're rolling around the marble machine X. This larger holder here has actually been redesigned, so I'm only temporarily tech welding it in place, and then I'm checking the distances in CAD between the openings, and as you can see it should be 131 millimeters and, well, just saying. So I can measure 131 millimeters on the table between these two scrap pieces of MDF, and then I can use that physical distance as a guide when I bend the PMMA pipe into the correct radius.
No, not good.
So when the connection between the string and the medical silicone rod broke, I thought I had lost the part and I had to smash the pipe to get the rod out. But I tried to put a screw into the other end of the silicone, and with some patience, I could actually get the silicone rod out and save the part, and was very relieved by that. So I'm cutting the top of the PMMA pipe off, and this is a design change that I made later on. I realized by cutting a hole in the pipe like this will make the marbles much more visible to the naked eye, so to speak. I sanded the bandsaw cut, and then I used a trick that this old Tony taught us, flame polishing. By stroking the sanded surface in the flame, the PMMA turns into glass. It's really beautiful. So here you can see the overflow of marbles. That's the marbles that are not needed inside the marble divider. By this in place, I could start to work on the top pipe. I immediately ran into this problem that the marbles are coming with too high speed, so they're skipping the first channels, and these marbles need to fall into the first channel if that one is needing marbles. So I tried different methods of slowing the marbles down. First I tried holding a little flexible flap, and that kind of worked, but the more elegant solution I thought was to kill the kinetic energy of the marbles by routing them through a longer route. Energy Killer Snake is doing its job pretty well. I might revisit that one later, but I could now mount my test bell onto the Marble X and start filling up the marble divider to test this system. The idea is that when the marble divider is full, the marbles will pass the divider entirely and go down into the bottom long pipe, the one we made first. Filling the marble divider up with marbles takes a long, long time, which gives me the opportunity to have a little chat with all of you about a pressing subject, the design of the programming wheel. I have received so much criticism for that design, or let's call it feedback. The general idea is that I'm overcomplicating things. And I can totally believe why you think so, because I have a habit of overcomplicating things. But as I mentioned in some comments before, I never said it in a video, in the case of the programming wheel design, I actually do not think that I'm overcomplicating it. I think it's a very complicated problem to solve. So to figure out what is going on with all this feedback for the programming wheel design, it could either be me falling victim for the sunken cost fallacy, that I've invested so much in this design, so I refuse to see other much simpler solutions as viable, because I'm just gonna stick my hand into the sand and stick with my idea because I love it so much, because I spend so much time on it, right? That's the sunken cost fallacy. Alternatively, people have mentioned that I might be suffering from second system effect. The second system effect is the tendency of small, elegant, and successful systems to be succeeded by over-engineered, bloated systems due to inflated expectations and overconfidence. Having inflated expectations is an occupational hazard of the artist. And overconfidence as well, definitely. I do identify with this description quite a lot, so I will say I see where that's coming from. So when I get this kind of feedback, I want to be wise enough to actually listen to it and to actually entertain the thought that I'm in total sunken cost fallacy denial, and that the programming wheel design is a bastard child of second system effect. And the thing that would really wake me up from this coma would be if I was presented with a simpler, elegant solution that actually worked. But the problem is that the solutions that I've seen being suggested from people who criticize the existing design are unusable or unpractical. These solutions are based on omitting some requirements, some design requirements. So if you take out some requirements, if you leave out the requirement that we need to play live and that we need to be able to change songs fast, we leave out the requirement that the programming pins needs to be within 1/10 of a millimeter accuracy in their position. These solutions might work, but they are not solutions for the problem that I am trying to solve. You are not allowed to remove function and say that you have solved the problem. I'm getting so defensive around this, it's so funny. I sound like a person defending his sunken cost fallacy situation. I am still entertaining the fact that I have overlooked the holy grail of programming wheel design. There's one suggestion that is very popular, that I should have one full circle per song, so I never have to reprogram it. That makes sense in some ways, and it doesn't make sense in a lot of other ways. And a lot of people are worried about how we are gonna reprogram this. We have a super good idea of this. We're gonna DXF cut programming template. So basically you have a thin sheet of plastic over the programming plate and you just put a magnet in every hole. Having all songs pre-programmed would be a luxury, but then someone has to build 50 of these sections and we have to carry 50 of these sections around. They're big, they weigh a lot. I don't know if it's feasible. I like that the pins are movable, so I can actually program and compose songs on the Marble Machine X itself, so I don't have to do everything in the computer. I can actually improvise, I can be creative on the machine in itself. You can actually stand in front of the machine and create your song there. And maybe when I overdramatized last week because I had too much video footage to make normal videos, I slay the dragon of the whole video footage instead, then people think, oh, it must be something easier. Anyway, this is my little rant about programming wheel design. So far, none of the suggestions I have received work 5% well, whereas the solution I have on the machine right now is working 100%. I think it's really interesting to see it like two sides. Either I'm delusional or either the feedback hasn't understood the problem. And of course, it's a mix of both. I love that you care about the machine and I'm hearing myself sounding super defensive. I think this is the hill that I'm choosing to die on.
That's a nice sound, isn't it? Thank you so much for watching, Killer Snake. And see you in the next week's episode. Let's see what the last one does. If my calculations are correct,